please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Celebrating 16 years of Young Turks.
Hello and welcome to Young Turks, India's longest running show on startups and entrepreneurship. I'm Shireen Bhan. On the show today, we put the spotlight on the growth of the gaming industry. First up, we bring you the story of Nazara Technologies, a mobile game company that might be one of the first from the gaming space to go public in India. Next, we enter the world of fantasy sport with Harsh Jain, the co-founder and CEO of Dream 11. And finally, we move away from the virtual world and meet Srishti Bakshi, who's literally walking the talk for women's safety. As per a Google KPMG report released in May 2017, the online gaming industry in India is expected to grow to $1 billion by 2021 from the current $360 million. That's a growth rate of 20%, with online gamers' community reaching 310 million by 2021. One of the earliest to spot this opportunity was Nitish Mithersen, founder of Nazara Technologies. Founded in 2000, there is now talk of an IPO, and sources tell us Nazara is set to list in the April-June quarter this year, in what could be the first public listing in the gaming space. Nazara could be valued at between 3,000 to 3,500 crores, and it's expected to give investor Westbridge Capital a 75 to 80 times return on its 12-year-old bet. Let's take a look at how being an early mover in the gaming industry has benefited Nazara Technologies.
While his family was in the textile business in Sangli, Maharashtra, Nitish Mithersen had his eyes on the gaming industry from a very young age. Looking at his passion towards technology, his father encouraged him to venture out of the textile mills and help Nitish set up his gaming business while he was still in college, and that was the starting point for Nazara Technologies. Nazara is today the leading mobile gaming company engaged in the acquisition of, value addition to, and distribution of mobile games across 61 emerging markets like India, Africa, Middle East, Southeast Asia, and Latin America. We asked Nitish what's been his formula to stay ahead of the game quite literally over the last 18 years.
One is a very laser sharp focus on building profitable business. I started the company in 1999-2000. I saw the whole dot-com crash really close and upfront, right? And what happened. And my biggest learning there was, do not start a company only on the basis of hype or basis of investor appetite, because that can change very quickly. And if your business does not have fundamentals, if it is not generating cash, if it's just burning money, then you can fall off the cliff very fast, right? And that's why since then, the focus has been in building a strong, profitable business, which is the hallmark of Nazara against most of our competitors, right? I think the other thing is, we've always tried to look at new technologies, new opportunities, but not over-invest in them until and unless the business model and the business opportunity has also become a reality. You know, our kinds of businesses, the technology and getting passionate about it and getting carried away is very easy to happen. They're all youngsters here, they love new technology. I think it's important to wear your passion cap and your technology cap, but also your business cap.
Having licensed mobile gaming rights to popular IPs like Chota Bheem, Royal Challengers Bangalore, Motu Patlu, Mighty Raju, Shikari Shambhu and Supandi, Nazara is one of the leading publishers by downloads on Google Play Store with 44.49 million downloads until September 2017 and 19.34 million downloads already in 2018. This competence in the gaming industry has also allowed Nazara to launch a seed fund to support gaming startups. Nazara has invested in Mastermind Sports, Moong Labs, daily fantasy sports platform HalaPlay, Next Wave Multimedia, and most recently NotWin Gaming, that is today the subsidiary company of Nazara. But what makes Nitish bet big on startups?
What we are looking for is some strong understanding of the space in terms of how the business model works, the game KPIs, whether it's consumer retention, engagement, how data analytics, how is the founder or the team there thinking about it, and how are they differentiating. we can come in at a very early stage because we understand that space. We're not a financial investor. We're not investing only for financial gain. It's far more strategic in nature. But we can also come in Series A kind of this. We don't have a fixed corpus because it's all our internal resources. So on a case-by-case basis, we do it. We normally take anywhere like a 26% stake. But in recent times, we've also taken majority stakes in companies.
Like acquiring a majority stake of 55% in Nodwin Gaming, the pioneer of esports in India, in January this year. And in turn, ESL, the world's largest esports company, invested in a minority stake in Nazara Technologies just last week. ESL is also an investor in Nodwin Gaming, and now with ESL's investment in Nazara and Nodwin securing exclusive rights of using the ESL system and platform for the next 5 years, Nitish is poised to exploit the opportunity in the esports business. And he surely has his eyes set on generating big revenues here.
On the casual gaming side, we've got consumer spends happening. This could be micropayments, there could be subscription. Then we have advertising by brands through video ads. These are the kind of formats that work on the mobile side. On esports, it's more of large brands coming in and sponsoring these tournaments today. User pay, tournament fees, tickets, all of these will still to evolve, but they will happen. In terms of revenues, I can't disclose a lot, but the stated numbers for last year, we did about 60 crores PAT is what I can share.
Backed by early investor Westbridge Capital, late last year, Nazara raised 330 crore rupees from IIFL Asset Management and 180 crore rupees from Rakesh Jhunjhunwala, who took a minority stake in the venture. Nitish's next move is to build a market for competitive online and offline gaming, create localized leagues and cups, and boost esports from a spectator point of view in India.
While the gaming industry in India is expected to touch $1 billion by 2021, fantasy sports has grown big in the country, and the industry is all set to break records when it comes to engaging sports fans and testing their sports knowledge and skills. With more than 7 million Indian fantasy sports players, the industry is growing at between 30 to 50% every year. We decided to dig deep and attend Game Plan 2018, India's annual sports gaming conference, which was held in Mumbai, to find out more. Shruti Mishra caught up with Harsh Jain, the co-founder and CEO of Dream 11, and the chairman, ISFG, also Vani Kola, the managing director of Kalari Capital, to understand the key investment opportunities, the legal landscape, and the future outlook of sports gaming in India. Take a look.
Your venture, Dream 11, is a fantasy sports gaming company that you founded in 2009. What made you bet big on fantasy sports back then? And can you take us through Dream 11's growth curve?
So I think it was completely driven by passion. And it was something that we knew the rest of India would also want. Hmm. Me and my co-founder are crazy fantasy football fanatics. Hmm. So we play fantasy EPL every day. And when the IPL launched in 2008 in India, we went to play fantasy cricket,
yeah,
and there was none. And you know, having studied in the US and UK, you tend to understand that 60%, 65% of sports fans play fantasy sports, and that you're not really a sports fan, hardcore sports fan, unless you've played fantasy. And in a nation where you have a billion cricket fans, something like this just had to be there. So we took it upon ourselves to start it ourselves. And as far as the growth curve goes, we've been able to grow this industry from about 2 lakh users in 2014 to 20 lakh users in 2016.
Okay.
To we've actually just crossed 2 crore users now.
Yeah.
And we're looking to get to about 10 crore users in the next 2 years.
So how soon are you going to turn profitable?
That's a much larger multi-billion dollar question for the tech industry, right?
Yeah.
So I think our focus is on being a strong revenue generating company.
Yes.
We have low headcount, we are capital light, people light business.
Yeah.
We have a strong revenue margin, and we're able to scale up rapidly as a pure play product tech platform with no delivery, no inventory, no warehousing, no logistic costs. Hmm. So in that sense, to answer your question, if I wanted to be profitable, I could be profitable today.
Okay.
But we choose to reinvest all our revenue into growth for the next few years.
All right. Vani, now you're an investor in Dream 11, and Kalari is also invested in a lot of other gaming companies, 99 Games and stuff. What makes you bet big on the gaming industry and especially now fantasy sports?
So specific to fantasy sports, we understood when we met with Hirsch how large this opportunity can be, and more importantly, how much there is a gap in the market for this fun, engaging product that I think for a sports enthusiast and a sports fan is unavailable today, right? So also we like to invest into products that really have a very deep consumer connect or an enterprise connect, but something that has a very long-term sustainability, right, as a product. So being in the people's business, it was more about investing in the person first and the market opportunity next for us.
Harsh, you're also the chairman of the Indian Federation of Sports Gaming. Take us to some of the regulatory frameworks that you're working on. What is kind of holding back the industry? What are the kind of changes you would like to bring in?
We started Dream 11 freemium per match fantasy sports back in 2012. And we were the only ones in the industry then. And by 2015-16, we had about 10 people in the industry, 10 operators. In the last year alone, there have been over 40 operators that have entered the industry.
Okay.
So now standing at 56 companies that run fantasy sports in India, we felt like it was time for an industry body to build this foundation for these operators to run their businesses and to make sure that we keep consumer protection and consumer interests at the foremost principle to grow this industry. We wanted to make sure we protect consumers by creating a charter, which is what every fantasy sports operator has to comply with. Simple things, right? Like you hygienic things that you can't provide this game to people that are 18 years or below. You have to make sure that you do KYC of all customers. You have to provide a certain set of formats which are approved by the Supreme Court. For example, in fantasy sports, you need to pick a minimum amount of players that are playing the actual match. So for example, in cricket, it's you need to pick at least 11 players in your team.
Yeah.
In kabaddi, you have to pick 5. And it has to be for duration of a whole match. So these are formats that are approved by the Supreme Court today, and we just want to make sure that we don't have one bad apple that spoils a bunch.
The daily fantasy sports industry in US and Canada alone is estimated to be $17 billion by 2020. Now, while India has a lot of catching up to do, today we have more than 7 million fantasy sports players, and fantasy sports is growing 30 to 50% every year. But how do you really tap into this community? You know, how do you really reach out to people? Because in India, people are consuming more of entertainment digitally, and you know, Candy Crush and Teen Patti is the favorite games that people are playing. So how do you really reach out to this community, even if there's so much potential?
I think this is a business where there's a lot of virality, or this is a product where we have seen tremendous amount of virality. And I think that's very important because this is a team play, you know, and so one person who really enjoys it then tries to build a community. It's not something you sit with a video console and play in your room by yourself. This is something that is a very engaging game. So I think what is important is to create that base that they form on your platform.
How are you intending to do that? Yeah,
the entire platform of fantasy sports is based on social sports fans, right?
Yeah.
So it's about a group of friends coming together, drafting their teams and saying, I understand sports way better than you do.
Yeah.
And I'm going to pick a player which you didn't know about because my research and my knowledge shows that this player is going to have a breakout year or a breakout game.
Yeah.
You have this inherent belief in everyone that they understand sports better than each other. And so fantasy sports gives them an opportunity to be an IPL team owner, own their team, and compete with their friends.
Okay.
The dominant majority of our users come via friends' referrals. They don't come via advertising, or they don't come via our marketing.
Yeah,
they
so come, it's all because word of mouth.
That's right. Okay. They come because friends circles. Once one friend starts playing, he or she gets all their friends to start playing and then competing with each other.
Now, let's talk about the legal landscape in India regarding fantasy sports. You know, while the Supreme Court has laid down that competitions where success depends on substantial degree of skill does not fall into the category of gambling, but what are the kind of laws that are needed to support fantasy sports?
The government has 10,000 industries to run, right? And while the while we build this out into a much larger industry and start proactively speaking to the government, it is our responsibility to formulate this industry and to formulate the way that it's run in a very, very professional manner and keeping in mind consumer protection at heart the most. And so on that matter, we've created a charter, like I mentioned, which lets operators know how to run their businesses in a legal and sanctioned manner, keeping...
Welcome back. You're watching Young Turks, India's longest running show on startups and entrepreneurship. Today, we put the spotlight on 30-year-old Srishti Bakshi, who's literally walking the talk when it comes to women's safety. Rattled by the horrific Highway 91 rape case, Srishti returned to India from Hong Kong and conceptualized Crossbow Miles. It's a mass outreach and engagement platform that's seen Srishti undertake a 3,800-kilometer journey on foot from Kanyakumari to Srinagar. Srishti conducts gender sensitization, digital and financial literacy workshops along the way and has the backing of Google's Internet Sathi project and the Tata Trust. Let's take a look at her story.
ऐसा पुनीत पावन और पवित्र विषय लेकर हमारी बेटी आज हमारे क्षेत्र से गुजर रही है।
ये वॉक से क्या होगा? You know, एक वॉक करके आप सोचेंगे कि आप जिंदगी मतलब लोगों की जिंदगी बदल देंगी? नहीं, I don't think so.
उनके माता पिता को मैं सलाम करता हूँ कि जिन्होंने ऐसी बिटिया को जन्म दिया।
My name is Srishti. I hail from a defense background. My father is in the army. Now he's retired, but you know, once an army is always an army. At the age of you know, young 18, I have left home and then gone to Mumbai to study. I knew my direction. That direction was that, you know, I started out with a dream of I'll become the CEO of Unilever. I moved to Hong Kong with my husband, and both of us were living in a place where we used to travel so much, and that is where conversations over dinner tables used to be something which would be like this, that you're from India, it is so beautiful. And then there would be a conversation about why is there so much violence against women in your country. I'm a patriot, I'm an army officer's daughter. I used to feel very strongly about, like, you know, the country, that no, the country is not just, does not offer only this to women, there are opportunities. And time and again I used to debate, only to lose the next morning, because I used to hear it again and again. With this at the back of my head, there came a time when I read about the Highway 91 case. I was on an evening bus back home, and I read about a mother and a daughter both gang raped in Bulandshahr in front of the father and brother. People's reactions would be, it's too painful, don't talk to me about it. Or, ye India hai, ab hum kya kare? You know, you can't do anything. You feel so helpless. And I felt that so many people felt helpless. And maybe this is what we need to change. Crossbow Miles app is an aggregator of initiatives which are working on the ground. I have seen a lot of armchair activism, which is Twitter pe dal diya, Facebook pe dal diya, and you know, that is what my role is, that's where it ends. I feel that people have to be propelled into action, and that is why Crossbow Miles is there. Crossbow Miles is it has collaborated with 19 initiatives on the ground, which works to empower women. What we do is we walk for them. I walk for them 30,000 steps every day. I invite people to walk with me, know about these initiatives. We raise awareness about them, and eventually we will raise money for them. Our understanding of the real India is absolutely zero. One thing that I would like to highlight is when we are walking across India, we have been able to figure out that the problems are very common. Like, domestic violence tops the charts. Domestic violence is 7 households out of 10. The reasons are early marriages. The reasons are alcoholism. The reason is that the woman doesn't have a voice. When I'm sitting in a class and I'm talking to girls and boys, I feel that the girls' voices are so muted. They are so underconfident. And this underconfidence is a gift from gender bias at home. That you are a girl, you know, laugh like this, sit like this, talk like this, you know, mute your voice. Thirdly is the police strengthening. That is another very big area of my research now. I have walked with 120 constables, SIs, IAS, IPS, and I feel that this is an organization which is undervalued at a very, very big scale. We are trying to put a paper together, and this is all going to assimilate in a research paper which is going to go through National Commission for Women to impact policy.
Tamil Nadu, I was walking across the highway and I came across a custard apple seller who was sitting by the side and she was selling custard apples. And this lady is trying to read in Tamil what I have written on the car. And the moment she reads, she has this bright smile. She gathers all the custard apples and puts it in a polythene and she runs to me. And she says that, you know, I know that till I am alive, the country is not going to be safe, but because you're doing this for my daughter, I want to thank you. You know, that was one of the first instances that made me believe that I am on the right track and I should just continue doing this. A lot of questions come to mind, like, you know, when you're on a journey like this, whether you're doing it right, whether this will have any impact. And that is the day I decided this is it. If you want change, then we have to be participant in this process. We have to start the change within ourselves first, and then the change will happen. We can't keep waiting for the change to come to us. So, you know, take on the onus and go out there and change the world.
Well, Srishti, keep walking and keep making a difference. Each of us must do whatever we can. Check out the Crossbow Miles app if you want to walk for change too. With that, it is time for us to wrap up this edition of Young Turks. Do tell us what you thought of our show. Write into us, youngturks@nw18.com. You can ping us on Facebook and Twitter. Till next week, from all of us here, goodbye and many thanks for watching.